Mr. Walsh. Okay, let me start with the famous speech of Feynman made in 1956, where he said, we got to a very, very small world. We have a lot of new things that would happen that represent the completely new opportunities of design. Following these ideas, there have been a lot of experimental achievements, such as the designing of nanostructural materials and quantum devices, such as quantum wire, quantum dots, and the topic, the quantum simulators. Okay, the motivation of quantum simulators concerns the many-body simulations. Here I stole a bit of a slide from Gifford et al., where he gave the some of the most important phenomena that happen in the many-body system, such as criticality, the topological orders, the quantum spin decrease, and the fractional quantum effect. Okay. It's a very interesting phenomenon. The challenge we have is that when we use the classic computers to simulate many-body systems, we are facing the so-called exponential wall. It means that the Hilbert space of this many-body system actually increases exponentially with your system size. One solution to beat this exponential wall is to dissolve quantum simulators, which is defined as a simple and controllable quantum systems do not mimic the complicated quantum systems. I give two famous examples, one of which is the controllable quantum simulator, and the other is the quantum simulator based on code atoms or code ions. And the quantum simulator is designed for a specific quantum problem. We have a more universal version for quantum simulators. We call it quantum computers. I give an example which is called the D-Wave quantum computer. This is formed by superconducting circuits as the computational block. However, still face the challenges on the such as the feasibility in experiments. We are fighting against the temperature and the instability and the size, the scaling of the size. Okay. Recently, we proposed the so-called quantum entanglement simulator. The idea of this work is to mimic the translational invariant in many-body systems of infinite size by only free-body models. For example, we have this 2D infinite quantum systems. The translational invariant is defined by this unit cell with two sides. And then the next step is to choose a finite bulk, for example, with 8 or with 12 sides. Then we define this cluster surrounded by this entanglement bus. Then in this cluster, in this free body system, we have the physical interactions inside the bulk and the physical bus interactions surrounding this finite bulk. This physical bus in Hamiltonian is calculated by the we call it ab initio optimization principle based on the tensor work. The goal of this work is to break the exponential work, because we are now going to face the free body model. Okay, let me first show you the results, numerical results. For the 2D Heisenberg model on infinite Kagome system, we only used 18 spins and 12 bus sites. Then we can accurately reproduce the results from the infinite system. This is the constant energy with different dimensions of the bus, chi, and this is the final size effects. Even though we are only using the very small cluster, the final size effect is only 10 to the minus 3. And this is 2D system. For 3D system, such as the infinite 3D Heisenberg wall transverse EC model on cubic lattice, we can see that we only use 8 spins with 24 bus sites. Then we can reproduce the properties of the infinite system, including the critical fields. Here, this is our result. This is a result from other very standard simulators, and as well as the critical exponents. You know that the criticality often appears in the thermodynamic limit. But however, we can reproduce this critical in a very small system. Okay. The mathematical tool behind this approach is the tensor network. This tool has been widely applied to many fields. One big application of the tensor network is the methodology for different numerical algorithms. It has a lot of applications in analytic and numerical studies, and also some study of physics. Here we would concentrate on this ab initio optimization principle approach for this quantum entanglement simulator. And I will also mention something about the machine learning. Okay. Let me introduce the graphical representations of tensor work. The simplest tensor is only a scale, which is a number. It can give you the partial function, the free energy, the energy, and so on. And for vector, it is the first order tensor. We represent it as a block with one bound. The bound is the index that label this the elements in this vector. And the matrix you can consider as a second order tensor. For example, the wave function of two spins. For n spins, the wave function of the coefficients can be written in the nth order tensor. Here, we different from the tensor fields. Here, we just consider as a nth order tensor as a bunch of numbers labeled by n indexes. So we do not, for now, consider any symmetries here. Okay. For many body states, normally the Hilbert space increases exponentially. However, with tensor work, we can lower the memory cost to a polynomial way. In 1D, we have the metric cross state. In 2D, we have the projected entangled state. And for critic system, we have the multi-scale entanglement randomization ansatz. These are different tensor work states. Meanwhile, we can encode this time evolution of the process into the contraction of the tensor networks. There we define these local tensors from this evolution parameter in local basis. Well, this time evolution can be a real time or imaginary time. For imaginary time, it would be the annealing process. With the tensor network, however, we will have some trade-off. One can see that if we want to really compute the properties of the tensor network, we have to do the contraction. Even if we get rid of this physical bound by observation or something similar, we will have to face the ancillary bounds that is inside this tensor network. The numbers of this bounds increase linearly. It means that we have to take some tensors whose memory cost increases exponentially with your contraction state. But however, for the same reason, we can see that this tensor network state automatically satisfy the every law of the entanglement entropy. It means that this tensor network state is a faithful representation for gap 2D wave functions. This is like the trade-off between the computational power and the computational complexity. Okay, due to the complexity, we need some algorithms to do this tensor network contractions. I give three famous examples, which are tensor cosquality tensor regularization group, quarter transmetric regularization group, and the time evolving block transmission algorithm. Okay, for more details, you can find more details in our recent view, which is about tensor network construction approaches. To define the tensor network simulators, we consider this tensor network construction problem in a completely different way. It means that by asking this question, is it possible to encode the contraction of infinite tensor network in the contraction of certain local tensors? Or what is ab initio in the tensor network contraction problems? Here we propose two principles. The first principle should be that this, the local function should be as simple as possible. For example, the contraction of local clusters, like this guy here. And the second principle is the input, number of the input parameters should be as little as possible. So we put the selfness as the input parameter. And then we can say that by defining this local eigenvalue equations self-consistently, we can encode this contraction of infinite tensor network into this local contraction problem. If you go in this direction, it's like a encoding process. Same thing if you with this equations, if you go in this direction, it looks like a decoding process from the local contraction of tensors to the infinite contraction of tensor network. Based on this idea, we can define the Hamiltonian for this quantum entanglement simulator. There will be three steps. The first two steps is implemented by classical computations just for obtaining this Feeding Boson-Hamiltonian on the boundary. With this Feeding Boson interactions, then we embed the final cluster inside this surrounded by this Feeding Boson-Hamiltonian, and then we have the quantum entanglement simulator, and we solve the ground state of this quantum entanglement simulator by classical simulations or quantum simulations. By solving the eigenvalue equations, we will have an evolution form which is given by this graph. However, if you want to realize in the experiments, you would like the standard summation for this. Actually, this is very easy by doing some transformation. And another fact we can see that is that the dimension of the bus determines the upper bound of the entanglement that can capture between the finite bulk with the infinite environment. This is what we call the quantum entanglement simulator. Okay. With this standard summation form, we propose that this quantum entanglement simulator may be realized in the experiments. We can use, you can see that the bus set has the simple physics, higher spins for spin models, or boson failures for bosonic fermion models, and the fitted bus interactions are pretty short range. You interact with the nearest neighbor feeding sites on the boundary. And also we can do the expansion of the feeding bus interaction in a complete basis of the formation matrices. We can choose different metric bases so that we can use change with between among the spins, bosons, and fermions according to the experiments. Here, there is a very optimistic design for universal quantum computer, where we use the quantum entanglement simulator idea plus the sensitive dimension scheme. Here, I want to say is that with this one device, by sharing different methods on this device, we can simulate different problems with the same device, such as the 20 plus 2 size QDS for 1D chain, or 12 plus 14 size QDS for infinite 2D square methods. This is a combination of the two different ideas. And for the algorithms, actually this QDS idea will finally give you an interactive model, even if you have a finite size, still it conveys interactions. Compared with the existing method, such as density function theory, or Arbitrary principle, or dynamic nuclear theory, the approximation is almost the nearly free electron approximation. So now here we are using interacting field body model, which we believe will capture more entanglement or many body effects. Okay, allow me to mention another workhorse based on tensor network, which is the neural learning with the tree tensor neural state. The general idea is to encode a class of images into the tensor network, into the tree tensor network states. The cost function is the summation of the fidelity between this vectorized image and this whole tree tensor network. This is also the label, so we use the supervised learning. We show that in fact, this tree tensor network state is the class of state that with slight entanglement, and it can be simulated by classical computations. We show that this kind of quantum state can encode the classical information such as images. Okay. Here, I choose some relations between the cost function, the arrow with the cost function we use here, which is the fidelity. Here, an important trick is that we constrain that all the tensors in the network is isometries. So this will guarantee that the trained tensor network state is a normalized state, is a well-defined quantum state in the Hilbert space. And also, by using the tensor network schemes, we know that the deviation from the identity, if you do this modification of this unit isometries, actually is the truncation error. We know that the collage in the Hilbert space is needed to capture this image classes. Okay, this is the numerical result on MNIST database. This is the bound dimension. You can see that with a small bound dimension, the training accuracy is already close to 1. But we find that the testing accuracy is going down somehow. This is, we believe this is overfitting. And this may relate to the, some, maybe the gas degree spread in the physical world. And this is some properly chose from dimensions. This is the training accuracy and the testing accuracy. You can see that we don't need high dimensions to reach accuracy that is better than 90. Okay, this is the benchmark of CIFAR database. This is the training accuracy. We can see that we only need the dimension like 5 or 4, we can have a very good accuracy in the training database. However, for the testing database, if we only use this kind of one dimension, the accuracy is near 80%. So we still need to push this algorithm to a very high accuracy. And another motivation to define this tree tensor network scheme is that by encoding the classical information into quantum state, we can use the quantum information theory to characterize the classical information, such as the fidelity that is actually distance of image classes from the real space regularization, and the entanglement characterizes the quantum complexity when you are developing algorithms, while all the information gained from element of one subsystem. So this is, we believe this would provide useful information. Okay, conclusion. Here I introduced two tensor network-based works. One is the tensor network-based quantum simulator, another is tensor network-based machinery. Despite the perspective, respectively, we believe that tensor network can hold somehow bridge these two different problems together. For example, here we have the physical Hamiltonians to simulate the many-body problems. Here we can also have the tensor network for this machine learning problem. If we combine these two ideas, it is, I would say that the possibility to finding the microscopic quantum models of the mimic intelligence will increase. This is our perspective for the future work. These are the collaborators with EE4 and the University of Chinese Academy of Sciences and Tianjin Polytechnic University. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Yes. How do you get the Hamiltonian on your batch sites from the full system Hamiltonian?
Firstly, we define the by Chow's social decomposition, we can define the tensor network that represents this meaning process. After that, we only have the tensor network to solve. Then we use this encoding idea. Then we can solve this boundary tensors under this central tensors here. For the boundary tensor here, actually this is a 2D version. For the boundary tensor here, actually it interacts with this feeding bulk. Then you will have some kind of this structure here. You can see that you have tensor here, you have the boundary tensor here. These two tensors just form the feeding bulk interaction, but it's in a evolution form because it's a product. Then we have this continuous NPS theory to guarantee that if we decrease the Chow's state, it converges to this free body Hamiltonian. The exponential e to the minus I tau, this guy, will give you this evolution form. Then we can, so we have the well-defined free body Hamiltonian, the standard summation form. So the key is to solve this boundary tensors by classical computations. Then if you have this, you have this, then you have this. After have this, you embed to the larger cluster, you solve the classical problem.
And it should probably be there.
There are not any more questions, Lane. Thank you once more.